Good evening, everybody. Welcome back to the digital platform of Sadhan Chandra Mahavidyalaya. As you know, the Department of English of Sadhan Chandra Mahavidyalaya has been organizing a special lecture series. We have already conducted 10 sessions. And today, I'm back. I, Gautam Maji, assistant professor, as well as head of the Department of English of Sadhan Chandra Mahavidyalaya, back with session number 11. In this very special session, we have a very special guest with us. She is Dr. Nikhila H. She is Associate Professor, Department of Film Studies, the English and Foreign Languages University, Hyderabad. Before introducing our Honorable Ma'am on our digital platform, I would like with a introductory video. So let's watch this video, and then I will welcome our distinguished guest on our digital platform. So let's watch it. Thank you very much for watching this special video, introductory video for our distinguished guest. So I'll not make any more delay, further delay. I would like to welcome our distinguished guest, our dear Nikhila ma'am on our digital platform. Ma'am, welcome to our digital platform, and thank you very much for accepting our invitation for this special talk. So ma'am, if you have anything to say about the venture that we have been doing, we'd be very much happy for that.
Hello, a very warm welcome to all of you who are tuned in to this session. It's really wonderful that Sadhan Chandra Mahavidyalaya from South 24 Paraganas is organizing this lecture series. I understand that this is the 11th session that they are organizing. in these difficult times that a university a department of English is taking this kind of an initiative to reach out not only to their own students but to the larger English community is really wonderful. I heartily congratulate the head of the department, Dr. Gautam Maji, who contacted me for this program and who has been coordinating this series. More than anything else, I'm very, very touched by the wonderful video, the introductory video that Gautam Maji prepared. I must say, Gautam, this has not happened before, so this is very unique. I've had my bio notes read out at various conferences, but nobody has done a video introduction. Thank you very much. I'm very honored and touched by this gesture. And I really look forward to this session and also to the presentation itself and to the questions and interaction that will follow. So I have a PowerPoint presentation to make, so which I will share now on the screen. And I hope that as we go along, there will be things that will provoke you in the presentation, things that you may find novel, things that you may disagree with, things that you may want to have a discussion on. I welcome all those at the end of the session. Now to the PowerPoint.
Ma'am, before you commence your lecture, then I'd like to say something for the participants or viewers who are watching us right now, that ma'am is going to deal with the topic that the topic is on your screen, recurrent recursion and permutation in adaptation, some observation on temporality in or of adaptations. So this is the topic that ma'am is going to deal with right now. And if you have any question, because who are quite newcomer or who have become the new participant of our series, that you are thinking of that, how can you ask the question? So don't worry about this. If you have, then I will come back to our honorable ma'am with those questions, whatever they will have, you will drop after her precious lecture. So I don't want to make you make this lecture delayed. So, ma'am, the session is yours, and please, we are eagerly waiting for your insightful lecture. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you.
I mean, just share your screen that I could take it, this one.
Yeah.
On this.
Yeah, I'm doing that.
I've got it.
Is it visible?
Yes, very much visible, ma'am.
Okay. So this is the topic, as Gautam mentioned, recursion and permutation in adaptation. I have a small hyphen in between. I'll come to that a little later. Some observations on temporality in and of adaptations. That's the title that I have given for my talk today. And the plan of the presentation goes something like this. To begin with, I preface this presentation with two short quotations. These quotations in some ways will give us a sense of what or how to see adaptation. Adaptation as a process of making and remaking of culture, and literature to film, which we kind of think as one of the only form of adaptation. I want to point out how it's one of the many forms of adaptation. So in some ways, these two quotations will form or will give us a larger sense of how I want to see adaptation. And then I'll zoom in on the specific topic itself, which is to do with recursion and permutation. So the second part of my talk will be on the recursive or the repetitive nature of adaptation. Why I use the term recursive, I will come to it again a little later. And the third and the last part of my presentation will look at permutation in two senses. What these senses are, again, I will come to it at the appropriate time. Permutation in adaptation, both in terms of the choices made out of the infinite choices that are possible to or the possible in the process of adapting. What does a director of a film choose, or what does the screenplay writer choose? So we look at permutation in terms of the infinite choices that are available and the choices that are finally made and the possible reasons and implications for the changes that are made. So as I said, I have prefaced this presentation with two quotations. The first is a really short one-line quotation. This is from Frank Kellita, who in an essay which talks about seriality, you know, series and serials, if we consider adaptations as a form of serials, not of, you know, bounded texts, but texts that open up into infinite variations. This is what Kellita has to say. He says, what we call culture is fundamentally dependent on the repetition and variation of narratives. These are two key terms. Remember these two terms when we talk of adaptation. Both these are very, very crucial. The repetition as well as the variation in the narratives. The second quotation is by Linda Hutchin, who's written this very interesting book on the theory of adaptation. And these are the opening lines of her book. It's very important for us to remember what she's saying here. She says, the Victorians had a habit of adapting just about everything and in just about every possible direction. The stories of poems, novels, plays, operas, paintings, songs, dances, and tableau vivant were constantly being adapted from one medium to another and then back again. She goes on to say, we postmoderns have clearly inherited this same habit, but we have even more new materials at our disposal. Not only film, television, radio, and the various electronic media, of course, but also theme parks, historical enactments, and virtual reality experiments. So the result, she says, adaptation is virtually everywhere. So there is a plethora of adaptations that is now available to all of us. Now, let us look closely at what happens in the process of adaptation. For some of us, we may think that adaptation is this process of retelling a story. Adaptation, I'm saying here, is not the repetition of a pre-existing end product called story, but it is the repetition or going over of an entire process of narration in time. So if you've gone, if you've read a novel and you're sharing with somebody that you're just, you've just finished reading a novel, they may ask you, what is it about? And you may give a two-line summary. Now, adaptation of a film from a novel is not this two-line summary that you give. It is actually this process of narration all over again. So it is what is called as bringing to life or staging the entire story before our eyes. So adaptation does not merely report. So as students of English grammar, you know about reported speech. This is what you know, A said or B said. Adaptation is not reported speech. It does not merely report the past, it stages the past. We see the past unfolding before our eyes. So the tense of the film for the most part is present tense, even when it is about the past, that is in flashback. So we see the flashback happening as if it is happening now before our very eyes. The relationship with the prior text is not one of seriality. So A happens and then followed by B. The literary text happens followed by the film text. So it's not a relationship of seriality in this fashion, but one of enfolding that text into the present. So what we have here is a relationship of enfolding, nesting, or embedding. I want to dwell a little bit upon this kind of relationship that prevails in adaptation. So what do I mean by enfolding? Adaptation enfolds the earlier text so that the relationship with the antecedent or the previous text is one of nesting. You see a picture here. Many of us would have played with dolls like this. So there is a bigger version, and then a smaller, and then a smaller. So there is a kind of nesting of each version. So they all may look similar, but there are also differences among them. So there are narratives, and there are narratives that resemble but are also very different. There is something of the element of the previous narrative, but it's not exactly the same. So it's a kind of embedding or nesting relationship that exists. Let me concretize what I'm saying with an example over here. You may all be familiar with this novel by Bapsi Sidhwa. It's called Cracking India. The other title that it is known by is Ice Candy Man. It was published in 1991. And you may be familiar with this film called 1947 Earth. You may remember that Amir Khan played an important role in this. And so does Nandita Das, you know, who plays the role of the Aya in this. Now, what I have on top of the screen is a quotation from the novel, which is the first introductory lines to Aya. Remember, the narration of the novel is by a little girl, you know, who Lenny, who is introducing us. So we see the Aya through Lenny's eyes, and this is what Lenny tells us the Aya looks like. Aya is chocolate brown and short. Everything about her is 18 years old and round and plump. Even her face, full-blown cheeks, pouting mouth, and smooth forehead curved to form a circle with her head. Her hair is pulled back in a tight knot. And then you have this film with Nandita Das. You know, these are the opening shots of the film. One is a kind of a middle kind of a shot to a long shot, you may say, somewhere in between. And the other is a closer, you know, close-up of the Aya. So here you see that there are elements of the novel, the description of the novel. But those elements are embedded within the larger visual that is presented to us. So there are, as you can see, differences. But these differences are not just, you know, serialic differences, one following the other. But elements of the previous description are kind of nested, embedded, enfolded into the description, into the visual that we see before our eyes on screen, so that the next time you think of or you go back to read the novel or go back to teach the novel in class, the image that you will get probably of Aya is this image of Nandita Das, even when you go back to read the novel. Recursion also occurs in another fashion. The adaptation may be based on a printed text, but the adaptation itself may give rise to and may be followed by the publication of another printed or verbal text in the form of publication of the screenplay or story based on the film version. So Ruskin Bond's story, Susanna's Seven Husbands, might have been published many years before Saath Khoon Maaf, the film, you know, came on the screen. But when it's republished with a still from the film, so that today we can't go back to Ruskin Bond's story except through, you know, our eyes, which are used to seeing Priyanka Chopra in the role of Susanna. So again, there's a kind of nesting or embedding. A similar example is this publication by Penguin of a translation of Sharat Chandra Chattopadhyay's Devdas. So obviously this translation has come after the celebrated, you know, film Devdas. And as you can see here, it's making use of a still from the film. So again here, there's a harking back to, or there's a harking to the film, and the film kind of enfolds or embeds the earlier text within its folds. Now I move on to the second aspect or the second prism through which one may want to look at adaptation. And I think somewhere this is very important for us to remember, you know, this particular aspect, which is the inevitability or the necessity of change. Very often, those of us, you know, who present or who discuss adaptation before our students or in seminars, one of the first things that people tell us is, I loved reading a particular novel. I did not like the film because it does not follow the novel. So the way I imagined the novel to be, the film was very different. So it did not follow the novel. Somewhere our expectation here is one of fidelity or matching, which, as you know, is a very, very sexist expectation, this expectation of fidelity. Now, what happens if a film exactly looks like or resembles a text, if at all that is possible? If at all it's possible for us to make an exact film that, you know, resembles the printed text in every possible way, then we will be in an absurd kind of situation like Borges' character. Borges wrote this very interesting short story called Pierre Monnard, author of Quixote. And if you can just take a look at, you know, these two quotations here. Truth, whose mother is history, rival of time, depository of deeds, witness of the present, exemplar and advisor to the present and the future's counselor. This is an example from Cervantes's Don Quixote, and exactly the same words. Truth, whose mother is history, rival of time, depository of deeds, witness of the past, exemplar and advisor to the present and the future's counselor. So if you expect exact fidelity, this is the absurdity that you will get. That is, if you have repetition without change, without permutation, this is exactly what you will have. That is a film that is really, you know, absurd, that whose presence is not necessary at all. When you have Cervantes writing the wonderful Don Quixote, who wants Pierre Menard's version, you know, however recent it is? So this, I think, you know, kind of captures the absurdity of us expecting that a film must be, or any text that follows, must exactly resemble or be like its predecessor. Permutation, as I said, I have used it in a compound fashion to, you know, draw your attention to two aspects. One is our two senses in which we can use the term. So one sense is the mathematical sense, where you have a number of options or choices and you choose one of them. The second aspect or the second meaning that arises is from the second half of the word, which is mutation or change. So I'm emphasizing both these aspects, the possibility of several options to someone who is bringing a film on screen, and the reason and the implications for making the kind of change that the person does while bringing a person, or that entity does while bringing the film on screen. So what are the possible reasons, or what are the possible implications of the changes? We'll look at some of these with a few concrete examples. Change could be because of the difference. That is, the film may change quite drastically from the novel, or quite might change, you know, quite a bit from the novel, because there is a difference in time between the publication of the book and the release of a film. I'm giving an example here from the Kannada context. The novel and the film may not be very familiar to you, but I suppose the point that I am making here will be quite familiar to you. So for a film to be called, or hopefully you will get familiar with the concept I want to introduce through this example. So for a film to be called adaptation, the assumption is that there is a prior printed text, that the time of publication of the printed text has preceded the release of the film, even if it's by a month or so. That change in time itself could become, an object of our study. So what does time do to a text? What does time do when that text has to be remade or adapted? For example, the change that results from the different contexts in which Kaduru Hegadati, this is a very, very celebrated novel by a Kannada writer called Kuvempu, a Gnanapit award-winning author. And the novel was published way back in 1934. Now, the film made with the same title, Kanuru Hegadati, was released in 1999. This film was directed by Girish Karnad, whom some of you may be familiar with. Now, what happens in Kanuru Hegadati? So Karnad foregrounds the three women characters. There are three very crucial, important women characters, Sita, Subbabba, and Nagamma, and shifts the focus from the male protagonist. So in the novel, the male protagonist, Huvaya, is a kind of Gandhian nationalist figure. The novel itself is based on the nationalist, in the nationalist context. And Huvaya is kind of someone who is introducing Gandhian nationalism into the milieu. So whatever happens in the novel seems to be not only through the eyes of Huvaya, but also justifying how Huvaya brings about change in the feudal order. But in the film, which comes in 1990s, what Girish Karnad does is he foregrounds the women and also gives importance to the women's choices, their so-called follies, which don't become follies now. Transgressions now are seen as bringing about the destruction of the old oppressive feudal order. So it's not so much the coming of nationalism that gives rise to the end of the feudal order, that makes for the end of the feudal order, but it is these women who and the contradictions of their life that kind of push feudalism out and bring about a dawn of the dawn of modernity or the new era. So this quotation is from the back flap of the VCD, and it tells us here how Subbamma, the mistress of the house, through her acts of defiance, through her own brand of revolt, avenged all the wrongs done by man to woman. And the last line is crucial. She destroys herself in the end, but not without putting up a brave fight against this machismo. So here she becomes, in some ways, the protagonist, the one who is the engine of change, not Huvaya as much as Subbamma. So why does this kind of a shift take place? The point is that Girish Karnad is making this film in the 1990s, late 1990s, almost on the brink of the 2000s. And he cannot make a film without taking into account the existing gender discourse. He cannot, or he sees the potential of bringing in a kind of gender discourse into this novel, where earlier it might have been simply on the periphery of the novel. The second reason for the change, the time of the story, here change could be because of the different ways of representing a particular past. That is, I'm using Hayden White's term, the term that he uses is Historia 40. So a novel and a film may differ from each other in their representation of history. Again, going back to the same example, 1947 Earth, it differs from, the film differs from the novel in its representation of partition. The film seems to be informed more by the new histories of partition, again, offering a gendered view of the formation of nations. Whereas the canvas of the novel is, very different. It is taking us through certain through you know a period of cataclysmic changes that take place, but all through the eyes of a child. In the film, it's more important for us to see what happens to the ayah. So the kidnappings that happened, you know, by members of one community against another, and the violence that happened against women. So that's the perspective that emerges. So there's a different way of narrating history. And there's a different kind of engagement of history. Although both the film and the novel before it were in the 1990s, you know, their ways of representing history is very, very different, and the discourse that informs them again are very, very different. Now, again, there may be a change in the story by changing the historical context. So you might bring about a different kind of historical context, you know, when you're making the film. Again, here I'm giving another very interesting kind of an example. This is a film by Girish Kasaravalli called Gulabi Talkies. Again, it's a kind of a film which is based on, supposedly based on a short story. The short story that it is based on, Gulabi Talkies and Small Waves, Mattu Sanna Alegalu, Gulabi Talkies, you know, the kind of transformation that happened in a particular small town with the coming of a theater or a talkies, as they used to be called earlier. So that's the context of the short story. But the film is very, very different. It's not talking about the coming of, you know, a theater, a theater where films are screened. Instead, it goes on to engage with another very important technological revolution, which is the coming of television to a small coastal village in the backdrop of Kargil War. The same could be said, I suppose, of Ghatak's film, which has recently been restored, subtitled, and is available. Ghatak's Boritheke Paliya is set in post-partition Calcutta. And I recently came to know that the novel, Shivram Chakraborty's novel of the same name, in which, you know, on which the film is based, was actually set in the colonial period. Whereas Ghatak's film is very much set in post-partition Calcutta. So, you can see a change in the historical context in this fashion. Now, there could be a change in time and a duration of the action, also keeping in mind the requirements of a film. A novel can, you know, for instance, run into 500 pages, 800 pages, or whatever. Now, a film cannot, you know, does not have the luxury of being very, very long. Of course, in today's times, you know, we have a number of web series, you know, that virtually every OTT platform is, you know, introducing us to. But if we look at cinema, the cinema that we watch in theaters, that is restricted to a specific run time. So there is a need to economize on the part of the filmmaker. So several pages could be economized in one, you know, particular scene. Or on the other hand, there could also be an expansion. Now, if you see, you know, the short story, Susanna's Seven Husbands by Ruskin Bond, it's only a 6-page short story. Now, this is expanded into a 148-minute film. So it's not turned into a short film. Instead, it is enhanced, expanded to make a short, a feature film, a longer film of 148 minutes. So keeping the runtime in mind, you could either economize or expand, you know, from the preceding text. And you have examples for both, you know, examples which will show this kind of enhancement as well as this kind of contraction. Now, not all actions of addition and deletion in the film is only due to temporal constraints. It's not that it's always, you know, that certain sequences are left out because the film has to fit into 1.5 hours or 2 hours. For instance, look at, you know, the deletion that takes place, you know, in 1947 Earth. It stops at a point where Aya gets kidnapped. Whereas this is somewhere, you know, the midpoint of the novel. The novel continues well after what happens to the Aya, because its interest is really, as I said, much larger. It is trying to take us through some very large changes that are happening, and all, of course, through the eyes of this little girl, sometimes uncomprehending, sometimes precocious. You know, she seems to know much beyond her age. So deletions are not always due to temporal constraints. A film needs to project a protagonist. It can't be about too many characters. Otherwise, you know, we may think that the film narrative will go awry. So there is the necessity to project one or two characters, which is what happens in 1947 Earth. And there are additions sometimes in order to shift focus. You know, or give a particular kind of legitimacy for the actions of a character. So if Subhama, if the woman, the female character in Karnad's film has to be foregrounded, he has to give her a backstory, which is what Karnad does. So introduces scenes which are not there in the novel. Now, there are various kinds of permutations that happen in the course of narration of a film. One of the most important such changes happens in the form of the narrator. Now, as you know, in a novel or a short story, you are familiar with discussions of point of view. You're familiar with, you know, the narrator as first-person narrator, second-person narrator, or omniscient narrator. In cinema, these narrators of these novels or short story, you know, are the ones who kind of tell the film in the present, as if it's unfolding before us. But film narrates not by telling. So there is no one who is actually identifiable very often as the teller of the story. Instead, what you have in film is the arrangement and composition of information from various sources. These could be visual sources, these could be auditory sources in the form of dialogues, it could be in the form of voiceovers. So various, through techniques of editing, juxtaposition of scenes, we get to hear the story as it unfolds, the narration unfolds before us. So you could think of, more than a narrator, you could think of a filmic composition device, some kind of an agent or entity in the film, which does this kind of arrangement and takes us through the narration in the film. Now, you know, many of you are familiar with this novel, I suppose, Wuthering Heights, Emily Bronte's celebrated novel. I suppose every student of English literature would have read this at some point or the other. The most interesting aspect of this novel, besides the characters, of course, is Nellie Dean herself. And one of the important discussions of the novel every time is this unreliable, so-called unreliable narrator that Nellie Dean is. Can we trust her judgment on the characters? So Nellie Dean and the perspective that she offers on the characters how we see the characters refracted through her point of view is a very, very discussed, much discussed aspect of Wuthering Heights. Many critics have written about this. Now, let us look at the film version. If you look at the 1970 film version of Wuthering Heights, there is a kind of voiceover which comes in the beginning. This is a form of disembodied narrating voice, you know, which is kind of a nod to the literary narrator. So the literary narrator comes in this kind of disembodied narrating voice just at the beginning and now and then. So the narrator does not remain with us throughout the novel, you know, so we don't get to see her like sitting in the corner of a screen and telling us, look at this, this is how Catherine behaves, this is how this character behaves. So Nellie Dean, you know, does not come in scene after scene pointing out what the characters do. Instead, we have her voice in the beginning and now and then, whereas if you look at the 2009 version of the film, it does away completely with the narrating voice. The umbilical cord with the literary text is cut. The film dispenses entirely with the narrator, voiceover or whatever, and instead works only through a filmic composition device, which is a more filmic device rather than something that you know, borrows from or is attempted to borrow from the novel. So the 2009 version uses an FCD, a filmic composition device, rather than having Nellie Dean in any form as a controlling, you know, narrator of that film. Now, the permutations, other permutations. So you may create the artifice, the film may create the artifice of a narrator recalling the past so that even when the past unfolds in the present tense, we know that it is the past or that the events are over. What do I mean by this? In 1947 Earth, you know, on the screen is the first scene where Lenny comes before our eyes. She's holding a plate, you know, glass plate, and then she breaks it. She puts it on the ground and breaks it. And the ayah comes rushing, you know, as soon as the plate is broken. And at the same time, we have a homodiegetic narrator, someone who is part of the diegesis or narrative. The voiceover comes in the form, the narrator comes in the form of this voiceover, and it tells us what is to happen, how, you know, partition happened and what happened, you know, with partition, with or what happened leading up to partition. What were the kinds of, you know, changes in people that came over with partition? So there is a voiceover. And finally, you know, this narrator appears only in the end. So we see her, there's a blackout on the screen. And then this narrator appears. Now she is all grown up. She's a person who, an adult, who is looking back at the past, maybe 40 years ago or 50 years ago. So this is a device which is introduced in the film, whereas in the novel, Lenny is the narrator throughout, and we see this child narrator throughout. So there is no adult, you know, looking back. So this device is completely done away with. Another very interesting change, permutation in time and tense of the narration, comes in the film Saat Khoon Ma. Now, the film moves between the past and the present through flashback and intercuts to the present, with the past finally catching up with the present as the film hurtles towards the climax. It has retrospective narration. So here is the narrator, this person who is telling the story of Susanna ostensibly to his wife. So he's looking at an old album of Susanna, and when his wife asks him, you know, what he's doing, he's kind of telling the story of Susanna and her husband's. So he goes back in time to narrate the story of Susanna. But he is only a partial narrator, because after a point in time, he does not know what has happened to Susanna. They have parted ways. So some part of the story is narrated by Susanna to this boy whom, you know, boy now an adult. Susanna now becomes the narrator as she, you know, tells her own story. Whereas if you look at the short story, so in other words, the film is mounted on a very, very complex process of narration with multiple narrators and with movements back and forth in time. Whereas the short story is pretty much straightforward. There is somebody who's asking a question, and there is a narrator who is telling the story to that person, to the interlocutor, to the one who is asking the question. So what happened to Susanna? And the narrator is telling us, okay, so this is what happened to her. So this is a very simple story, which becomes a very complex kind of narrative structure when it morphs into a film. So I think I'll stop here at this point. My aim was to take you through and provoke you to think of very many different kinds of changes that may happen, and why these changes may happen in the process of adaptation, rather than to just think about or mourn that the film is not good enough or it does not meet your expectations. Of you know, the literary text. Gautam, I think I will stop at this point. I will be happy to take questions and you know, clarify anything to those who are with us today. I'll
okay.
Stop now. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, ma'am, for this intriguing session, because really we have learned a lot from your very insightful lecture. So once again, thank you very much. So I hope that you can find the screen right now, because okay, there is the one question that I can find. I'm taking it on the screen so you can find the question.
Yeah.
Okay. I hope that you can get the question.
Yeah. Thanks, Disha, for the question, and I'm glad you found it interesting. So this is Manfred Jahn's concept, M-A-N-F-R-E-D, Manfred, J-A-H-N, Jahn, his concept of FCD. Now, the question that many, you know, film narratologists have engaged with is, who narrates in film? So this is a very, very, you know, important question that has quite troubled many film narratologists, and various people have come up, various theoreticians and scholars have come up with various kinds of, you know, explanations of this question, who narrates in film. Commonsensically, when we speak, we may say, oh, the director. So the director is telling the story. But the director is someone who organizes outside of the diegetic universe of the film. He's not part of the diegetic universe of the film. So in that sense, it would be quite a misnomer to you know, call the director the narrator. Just as in literary studies, you all know that you have to make a distinction between the author. Emily Bronte is not, you know, Nellie Dean. You have to make a distinction between the author and the narrator. So if we try to make such a distinction, the question that comes up is, who narrates in cinema? And as I said, different people have proposed different explanations. Some say, you know, the director, some say the film narrates itself. Some say there is some kind of implicit narrator. So that's another term that people use. Some say that, you know, it is almost as if self-agential. So it just kind of unfolds on its own. But I think Manfred Jahn's term FCD, filmic composition device, is a conceptual term. So I'm not saying there is actually someone, who sits there to tell us the story. It's a kind of device which, as scholars of cinema, when we talk about film narratology, it's useful to think of this FCD that is doing this or carrying out this function of narration. Now, what does this entity do? What does FCD do? Now, it's very interesting for us. As you know, film unfolds in time, right? So some entity must be deciding or determining what information to release when. So the first few minutes, we are all puzzled. So what is happening in the film? And as the film unfolds through various kinds of mechanisms or various kinds of sources that film has at its command, that is, it has auditory sources, it has dialogues, it has music, it has voiceover, through visual sources. These visuals may be in the form of characters appearing on screen, and these characters are dressed in certain kinds of ways. There is the mise-en-scene, there is lighting, there is camera work. So there must be some entity that is organizing all this to tell a particular kind of story. If it's a narration meant to confuse us, sometimes the visual and the verbal aspects may not match each other, so they don't actually go in harmony with each other. Now, if you ask, so who's making these decisions? So the FCD seems to be determining what information to relay to you when, what effect that relay will have on you. Will it help you to continue? Will it keep you engaged enough to continue with the narration of the film, to find out, okay, so what is happening? What happened next? Or will you become, kind of disengaged? Will you be puzzled? Will you be hooked on to the story? So FCD, John's term, I have found it fairly useful to discuss this, to discuss film narration using John's concept. I hope this answers your question, Disha.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for this wonderful answer that you have given to this question. So several messages have come that they have liked your, as we know that, there is one question, as the case, it is difficult sometimes to adapt. Okay, there is one question. I'm taking the question on the screen. This question is very broad question, so your face might be obstructed with the question, but I'm taking this one so they can read it out.
Yeah.
No, it's very simple. Okay, you can just read it out.
Yeah. So as far as the 1970 version of Wuthering Heights is concerned, the whole text has not been adapted. So it's difficult sometimes to adapt a huge text, or as the case may be, how does the adaptation contain the main message of the text? Yeah.
Very good.
Babul Pramanik, thanks for this question. I gave you various examples, where the film is a kind of, or adapting is a process of nesting, I said. So we don't have to work with the concept of whole text, entire text, main message. So there is a kind of relationship of nesting. I gave you this visual of dolls that we have played with, one doll going into another. So in that sense, the film kind of nests earlier versions of the text. For instance, I'm talking about versions in plural, because I think there was a 1930s version of the film as well. And as you know, Wuthering Heights itself has various editions of the text. This would be true, let's say, even of translated text. So there may be no one particular source text, but many earlier versions. So the later versions have a kind of nesting relationship. And talking about this aspect of main message, the main message for you may not be the main message for another reader, right? So we are not talking so much about the message. If you the example that I gave, you know, of Kuvempu's novel, if one has to you know, kind of draw out the dominant strand of that novel, it would be nationalist discourse or Gandhian nationalist discourse. But various other discourses are also there, which is why when a film is made, all the other discourses, particularly the discourses relating to gender, are now programmed or brought into the dominant domain. So I don't think, and as you know, Bakhtin also talks about these multifarious voices that are there in a novel. So there is no one main theme or main voice. There are many different, you know, kinds of voices and kinds of themes in the novel, which a film, for whatever purpose, you know, when it is remade, you know, adapted into a film later on, may want to foreground or highlight. So there is some aspect of the earlier story in the new version that comes before us. And as I said, you know, this desire for comprehension and this desire to look exactly like the novel may not take us very far in our discussion of adaptation. I hope in some ways I have addressed your question.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for this wonderful answer. And there is lots of messages that they have wished to you. And okay, there is another question. Francis D'Souza, most probably. Yes, I'm taking this one on the screen.
Yeah.
Ma'am, okay, you could read it out.
Yeah, Francis D'Souza will know the film that I'm talking about, Girish Kasaravelli's Gulabi Talkies. So he's pointing out how when the film came out, it also conveyed more about the complexities of coastal Karnataka, especially slipping into communalism. Would you like to throw some light on this? I think it's very, very interesting, you know, and I'm glad Francis D'Souza is, you know, has brought up this point. Now, one of the reasons for the change. So, as I said, Vaidehi's short story is about the coming of cinema. And one of the things that happens in the short story is the move for, particularly for women, from the private sphere to a public sphere. So, cinema opens up the possibility of this kind of movement from the private sphere to a public sphere when cinema comes to this small town. Now, what happens in the film? In the film, as I said, it is about the coming of television. And what does television do? Television pushes us back out of the public sphere, back into the privacy of our homes. So the movement is in the opposite direction. Cinema took us outside, whereas television brought us back into our homes, into our individualistic, fragmented existence. Not only did it do that, what else does it do? Television brought into our homes, into our very lives, something that was happening in a very, very distant terrain. Earlier, we might have read about Kargil War only through our newspapers, but television staged it before our eyes. So, and where? In the very vicinity, in the very intimate space of our homes. So an issue, and we are learning it more and more, you know, this has only gone on to multiply in its effects. So something that happens very far away from us, which is very remote, you know, spatially from us, and, you know, may become something that invades our intimate and private space. So communalism takes on a whole new color. So the shift is not only in terms of the shift in Kasaravelli's film is not only in terms of time. So So a film which is set in the 19—I mean, a short story which is set in the 1950s or 60s, the coming of cinema to 1990s. But it also has all these kinds of ramifications. And interestingly, one of the characters in this film says something very, very poignant, I would think, very moving. So the character says, earlier, I would, go out and watch the same film. And every time I watched the film, it was a new film, right? So every time I went out to the theater, I might be watching the same film. And many of us watch a film several times, right? So, but each time when I watched it, it seemed like a new film. Today, television has come into my home. There are hundreds of channels. There are hundreds of movies that I may watch or hundreds of serials that I may watch. But unfortunately, every time I watch one, it looks exactly like the other. So the kind of widening of horizons of cinema versus the contraction of horizons of television. I think both these aspects, work very well in Kasir Ali's film. So coming back to the question of adaptation then, I think it's important for us to see here what kind of relationship the film has with the earlier short story. It's entering into a kind of dialogue with that short story. So it's not just taking out a main theme or taking out a character from that story and recontextualizing it. It is also entering into a kind of dialogue with that short story in so many different ways. Thanks, Francis D'Souza, for the question.
Okay, ma'am. We have a question. Most probably, he is your student. I'm taking the question. Chandra Chandru, okay. Thank you for your interesting session. What adaptation of movies like Omkara to be considered? What sort of adaptation?
I don't completely understand, what sort of adaptations. Well, in some ways you can call it, I mean, there are different terms that are used here. You could say localization, for instance, is a term that is used. So take Shakespeare out of, and there are many, plays which have done that, as well as films which have done that. Taking very popular plays of Shakespeare and recontextualizing, giving them a very different kind of context, whether it's with Hamlet or Macbeth, so you can see something, or Othello. So you can see these kinds of changes that happen. So both spatially and temporally, I think the transformations are very, very interesting. So it's an interesting question to ask. So why do these films not claim that they are independent? Why do they claim to be adaptations? I think for informed readers or viewers like you and me, it's very interesting to see this kind of relationship that exists between the film and the resonances that Shakespeare's play might have, for us. So in some ways, in translation studies, they may say this is a kind of localization or domestication that is happening, bringing a set of alien characters in an alien context closer to us, bringing them or staging certain conflicts in our present in terms of the past, so as to see them more or less as universal kinds of conflict. So that too could be happening by this process of localization. Thanks, Chandra, for this. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. As I find no question now, so I must just convey my heartfelt thanks to you, because thanks is a very mere word for you, because it's a really wonderful session, and I have learned a lot from this session. And so thank you very much, ma'am, for this lecture. And please, I'm removing you from the studio, but be there. Okay, there is another question on this. Let me check this. in the text instead of the variables. Okay, this is a particular question. I'm taking on this question on the screen.
Kokila, Krishnan, film studies is a great synoisseur for connoisseurs within literature. Film adaptations are hugely helpful in comprehending the text well and in understanding the nuances of all the literary elements as well. Mm. Could you suggest
some of the themes to be researched? Okay.
Yeah. Kokila, thanks very much for this question. I think it's a very important question because, you know, many of us may be familiar with two kinds of frameworks which have been kind of done to death, you know, in adaptation studies. One is this kind of fidelity criticism where we are constantly, you know, just talking about the novel and the film. And film as an inferior, in some ways, inferior version of the novel, not imaginative enough, killing imagination, whereas novel opens up imagination. So in that sense, this kind of fidelity criticism is one framework that has dominated in all discussions of adaptation studies. The second is a kind of comparative framework. I think it's high time. So comparative framework, again, where we compare the film with its predecessor and see how, you know, these two texts differ from each other. I think they have their place. I may not, you know, say that they are entirely useless, but I think it's important for us to look at very many different things that happen or that take place through adaptation. I think one of the most interesting aspects in adaptation studies or research in adaptation studies is to look at, you know, the adaptation as a process of seriality. So we often tend to think of texts as bounded entities and we may think that the only kind of relationship, you know, that exists with another text would be intertextual. So a film referring back to a novel. But what this seriality allows for, or what we understand through conceptualizing adaptation as a process of seriality, is to look at narratives as endlessly reproducible. So remember the quotation I began with, where you know, Kelliter talks about culture as this process of repetition. So repetition and variation. So it's interesting for us to look at, you know, these kinds of serials or these kinds of sequences of transformation that happen to a text. And each time as these transformations happen, what happens to its predecessor, what happens to the source text? You know, to recall Walter Benjamin, you know, Walter Benjamin talks about the afterlife of a text. So in some ways, the film or whatever a text that comes later gives a kind of, you know, of brings back to life a text that is dead and gone. So one, of course, is this kind of presentness, or you know, the change in temporality, which gives this kind of presentness to a text, but also the sense of opening the text to further and further narrations, right? So adaptation can be seen as one of the many sequences. A good example of what I'm trying to tell you is, you know, a film, probably a film like Devdas. So virtually every decade in Indian cinema has seen a version of Devdas. So what is this compulsion to retell this story of Devdas? Has it remained the same? What are the kinds of transformations that have happened? one of the projects that I had given to one of my MA students, many years ago, was to kind of dig out the number of versions of Devdas. And at that point in time, she had come up with some 13 or 14 versions. I'm sure, all of you would be aware of many more versions today. So one of the most interesting questions to ask then about adaptation is, what is this compulsion with certain narratives to replicate and retell the story? And what is this narration? And what is this? What does this replication do each time that it is told? Each time that it is told differently. So rather than just be limited to a textual study, then it can tell you something about cultures in flux. So cultures which indicate both continuity, but also cultures which indicate. In terms of the changes that take place, the normative systems, we think norms are immutable, unchanging. But there may be something to say by looking at adaptations and the way these transformations occur about larger cultural questions or larger social questions. So I think if we push adaptation studies out of this narrow framework of textual comparison, the possibilities for research are endless. Also looking at, I took up a very small aspect today, which is to do with temporality and narration. But there are many very interesting and diverse aspects of, filmic narration itself that one can take up for study. I mean, if we are interested, I mean, so narratology itself is a very evolved field, and changes in narration is also something very, very interesting to take up. We could discuss further, of course. At the moment, these are some of the things that are occurring to me.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Actually, I was listening to you with rapt attention, and I wanted it to go on, go on, and go on. I don't want to put an end to this one, this discussion that you are doing. It's a wonderful session, I must say, and I hope the several messages we have received that they have really liked this one, and they have learned a lot from your session. So thank you very much, ma'am, for delivering your insightful and intriguing lecture on our platform. So I'm removing you from this broadcast thing, but be there, I'll talk to you, and then okay, thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much, viewers who have watched this session. And one announcement I have for you, that tomorrow there is another session, and this session is going to take place from 7:30 p.m. And in that session, a special lecture will be delivered by Dr. Bashmi Chakraborty. So not from 7 p.m., but the lecture will commence from 7:30 p.m. onwards. Thank you very much for watching our sessions. And if you have any problem, any issue, anything, any suggestion, do drop your comment in the comment box. Or if you have registered for any session, then you could send us suggestions also. We will definitely work on your suggestions. Thank you, and good night to all of you. Be safe, and enjoy this day. Thank you very much.